Hello everybody, I am Nico D. Today I'm back with another new single board computer. It's the RockPi 4B. It looks a lot like the Raspberry Pis, but it has got more in common with the NanoPi M4. Both have got the same SoC, so the RK3399. They may have got the same brains, but they do have got a different body. A lot of things are different on both of these computers. So for example, this one has got LPDDR4 RAM, this one has got LPDDR3 RAM, this one has got an M.2 NVMe SATA port over here. This one doesn't have that, but it has got these extra GPIO pins which can be used for the same thing. On this one, the MIPI CSI and the MIPI DSI ports are compatible with the Raspberry Pi ports, so you can use the Raspberry Pi cameras and the Raspberry Pi display on this board. While from this one, these are proprietary and you can only use a camera from Friendly Elec and displays from Friendly Elec on this one. It also has got something in common with the Tinkerboard. The Tinkerboard has got colored GPIO pins and this one also has got colored GPIO pins. So it's got the best of many worlds. This one is also powered with USB Type-C PD, so it is quick charge, so it can be powered with 5 volts. When it isn't enough, it goes to 9 volts. When that isn't enough, it goes to 12 volts. It can go to 20 volts. So this is great. You can also power it with 5 volts, but a quick charger is better. This ensures the stability of the voltage on the USB ports. With this one, you can only power it with 5 volts. So if you use a high current, the voltage will drop from this one. So the design is really rock solid of this board. It's very new, so the software isn't perfect yet. But they are working very well on it. Every problem that I've encountered, they have fixed it quickly, so that is great. So I like this board a lot. So let's go to the specs. To start, it's got Gigabit Ethernet with Power over Ethernet support, but this is only the B model, the A model doesn't have that. It has got two USB 3.0 ports. The upper one has got OTG and both are dedicated, so you can use them both at maximum capacity. And then we have got two USB 2.0 ports. Then we've got the 40-pin GPIO header and above that the Wi-Fi chip. This also supports Bluetooth 5.0. Then the MIPI DSI connector, so this is compatible with the Raspberry Pi displays. Then the USB Type-C DP ports, so this supports quick charge. We've got HDMI 2.0, this supports 4K. Then the MIPI CSI port, this also supports Raspberry Pi cameras, and then the 3.5mm audio jack. On the back side we have got the M.2 NVMe SSD connector. This supports NVMe SSDs up to 2TB. Underneath that we have got the micro SD slots. Then the eMMC connector. This supports modules up to 128GB. These are compatible with the Oldroid and the Pine64 eMMC modules. Of course we have got the RK3399 system on a chip on the underside. This runs at 4x1.4GHz for the small cores and 2x1.8GHz for the big cores. With the small heatsink provided, I advise not to go higher than that, but they will bring out a bigger heatsink and with that you will be able to run it at 1.5GHz and 2GHz for the big cores. My board came with 4GB LPDDR4 RAM, this is dual channel. You can also buy a 1GB model or a 2GB model. And as last, there is the real-time clock battery connector for time backup. To download the operating systems, I type in this address in a browser. And then of course go to downloads. There we see Android TV, Android, Debian Desktop and Ubuntu Server. So Debian Desktop is ARMHF, so 32 bits, and Ubuntu Server is 64 bits. So let's start with Debian Desktop. Debian ARMHF has got some problems. For example, Chromium doesn't work. Also, Kden Live cannot play videos. These are the same problems as with TinkerOS, so maybe they used TinkerOS as a base for this OS. Firefox also doesn't work, so we need to find another solution to serve the internet. I again installed Vivaldi. Vivaldi works great, but it's not perfect. So to install it, you type in this. To install the deb file, I use GDebi package manager, but we first need to install it. So sudo apt install GDebi. Then we open GDebi. Then click open. Go to the home directory and choose the Vivaldi deb file. Then click install package. But then I ran into a small problem. I need the root password, but I don't know it. So for this, I open a terminal and then type in sudo pass wd. Then I type in a new password 2 times. And that is now the root password. So after that, we can just install Vivaldi Browser. If we now try to open Vivaldi Browser, then you see that it opens and it works. When I go to YouTube, there is no sound for the moment on the HDMI. So I will show you how to configure this. A lot of people have asked about this. So all we need to do is go to sound and video, there pulse audio volume control. It doesn't use ASA mixer anymore, so I think that's where people get stuck. Then go to configuration and just turn off the device you don't use. The 3.5mm audio jack also works great. As you can hear, the audio works fine now. I finally was able to buy an HDMI capture device, so what you see and hear is what I see on my screen. As you see, the YouTube playback isn't perfect here, there are about 50% dropped frames. Then onto the Ubuntu server image. So this is a 64-bit operating system. This is only Ubuntu core, so without a desktop, so we need to install the desktop ourselves. So to log in, the login name is Rock and the password is also Rock. On the first boot, Ethernet doesn't work, so we need to activate it first. So to do that, you type in these things. To connect to your Wi-Fi network, type in all this and replace ESSID name with your Wi-Fi network name and ESSID passwords with your Wi-Fi passwords. Then of course the first thing we need to do is sudo apt update and sudo apt upgrades. Now we can start installing a desktop. So I will be using Mate. I like Mate, but if you want to install another desktop, you can do that also. So here is how you can do that. This will take a long time. For me, it was more than an hour. I did it with Wi-Fi. It would be faster with the Ethernet, of course. So when all that is done, all we need to do is reboot. So type in sudo reboot and then wait until the desktop loads. This will take some time. Something I always do with every SBC is add a frequency monitor. Here I add 2, one for the big cores and one for the small cores. And what I also always add is a temperature monitor. So here in Mate there is no working temperature monitor for the taskbar, so I make one myself. So we add a command. And then type this. This is very important that you can see the temperature of your board, and certainly with this board. I will show the temperatures later. Without a fan, it is really high, so you really need to check the temperature for the safety of the boards. On the upper taskbar, I add a network monitor. And as last, I add a resource monitor, and here I configure it so that I also can see the memory loads. Here in Ubuntu 64-bit, Firefox is installed and it works, but it is very laggy to surf, so for that I use Chromium, but Firefox is really great to watch videos. In 1080p it works great without any dropped frames.
welcome to another video from explainingcomputers.com. This time,
to play video, VLC is installed by default in Mate Desktop, but it doesn't work well out of the box. So this is a 1080p video, so as you see it is a little bit laggy. We can improve that by going to Tools, then Preferences, then Video, and change the output to X11. Others may also work, so you can experiment with this. So 1080p plays well, but not in all file formats, and 4K doesn't work. So this file is 4K, and this just doesn't work. There are people working on it to make it workable in Linux Desktop. We just need to wait some time for that. It's gonna be soon. In the benchmarks, the RockPy does really great. So in ARMHF Debian, it was 1 hour 58 minutes for the BMW Blender benchmark in 1080p and 1 hour and 17 minutes in ARM64. So if we compare that with the NanoPy M4 at the same clock speed, you see that it is quite a bit faster. And if we compare that with the NanoPy M4 while at 1.5 GHz for the small cores and 2 GHz for the big cores, you see that it comes close to that. As we know, for Blender the RAM speed is very important, so we see that here. Then the 7-zip results. So in my video about benchmarking SBCs, we've seen that ARMHF is faster with 7-zip. So here we see again that it is much faster than the NanoPy M4 at the same clock speed. This seems a bit weird to me because I didn't know that RAM speed for 7-zip was this important. And if you compare it to the NanoPy M4 at 1.5 GHz, 2 GHz, you see that the ARMHF is almost the same. So the RockPy 4B seems faster than the NanoPy M4. To be sure, I also did a Kdenlive video render benchmark. So here again we see the same behavior. It is a lot faster than the NanoPy M4 at the same clock speed. And it is almost as fast as the NanoPy M4 at 1.5 and 2 GHz. As I already told you, this board gets very hot, so you really must use a fan with it if you use this small heatsink. With the bigger heatsink this will be a lot better. So the no fan idle temperature is 50 degrees Celsius in Debian ARMHF, and the throttle temperature is 85 degrees, but it keeps rising to above 90 degrees Celsius. In Ubuntu ARM 64 this is even worse, so the no fan idle temperature is 56 degrees there. And it keeps rising to above 95 degrees Celsius if you don't use a fan while it is maxed out. So you must use a fan. Even with the fan it gets 83 degrees Celsius in Ubuntu ARM 64. Then the power consumption. It uses a little bit more than the NanoPy M4 at the same clock speed. As conclusion, this is a very well designed SBC. I really like it. It's very fast. It is faster than the NanoPy M4, which has got the same SoC. The software needs a little bit more work, but Ubuntu works really well. Ubuntu is my favorite to use. There are plans to get Armbian support, so that would fix a lot. About the hardware side, I can't say much wrong. It is a better design than the NanoPy M4. It has got an M.2 NVMe SATA port. It's got LPDDR4. It is Raspberry Pi compatible with the MIPI CSI and DSI. It is powered with USB Type-C PD. That is very good for the voltage stability. It does need a better heatsink, but they are working on that. The only thing I don't like about this design is that the power LED is way too bright. But otherwise they have done a fantastic job with it. They seem very committed to improve the software, so that is very good. Without good software you are nothing with very good hardware, but I truly believe this will get in shape the next months. I also like that it looks a lot like the Raspberry Pis. That was the first thing that I've noticed when I saw it, and I was immediately intrigued by this SBC. So I am very happy I have this one. I will keep you all up to date about the progress of this board. Thank you all for watching. See you later. Bye.